Are we on? We good? God is good.
God is great.
All the time.
All the time.
Good morning. Welcome to worship at Duluth First United Methodist Church. And happy Mother's Day. This is our... Thank you. This is a special day. And if you're not sitting by your mother or being with your mother today, make sure you call your mother. Or call that mother that, or that woman that's like your mother. Let's not forget those women too that are very special to us. So we're so happy you're here today to worship with us and everybody online too. Good morning. And if you would please rise if you're able. And we will ask the Lord to be with us this morning. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this wonderful day that we can celebrate our mothers. And we know how important your mother was to you as well. And we just so blessed and thankful that we can feel that love from a mother and that love from you, Jesus. We ask you to come and be with us, Lord, and help us to put all of our worries and our woes at your feet and let you take care of them and forget about them. And let us just enjoy being in your presence and sitting on your lap, feeling your love and your arms wrapped around us. Lord, we love you so much, and we are here to worship you. Be with us now. We love you, and we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Awake and alive. cross is my beginning. The line drawn in the sand. The end of all my striving. Now I am born again. There Jesus was forsaken, so I will never be. His grace is my salvation, the gift of God, the work of Calvary. It is done. It is finished. Christ has won. He is risen. Grace is here. Love has triumphed over death.
Thank you.
sign of love.
Ah, there we go. All right, that'll work too. I hate to have to go into loud mode. All right, well, good morning. Welcome to Duluth First United Methodist Church. It is good to have everybody here this morning. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Scott Ellis. It's great to see you. If you're here in person, that is tremendous, and we love having you here. And if you would, we'd love to know you were here. If you would take the attendance pad and sign it and pass it down, that's terrific. If you're joining us online, we're glad you're here with us that way as well. And please be aware there is a link you can sign. We'd love for you to register your attendance that way, if you would, please. That'd be terrific. So as we prepare for our time of offering, with those who are assisting with this morning's offering, please come on up. There we go. All right, and let me remind you, obviously, you can give here in the basket. You can go to DuluthUMC.org. It's live television. You can go to DuluthUMC.org and give, and there's also a link in the video if you'd like to give that way. That also works. Now, let us prepare our hearts and minds for this act of worship through our giving. So please join me in a moment of prayer. Dear God, we come to you this morning and we thank you for all of the blessings that you have so generously shared with us. And as our act of worship this morning, we come to you with our gifts and our offerings. We ask that you would bless each and every gift, bless each and every giver for the expansion of your kingdom here on earth, Lord. Amen. All right, as we collect our offering, do we have any prayer concerns? Do we have any praises we'd like to offer up this morning? Any prayer concerns? We'll continue to lift up Lisa Marvel as she goes through her chemotherapy. Renata Walker has to be off her feet for 3 weeks. Oh, yeah, all students and teachers. We've got some college kids that have wrapped up or are wrapping up, and the high school kids are getting close to finals. I think, yep, let's hear it. I've seen at least pictures of one recent college graduate. The halls are very smiley today. Congratulations. Marvels are very smiley. They got another one off the payroll. That's great. So fantastic. And like I said, the high school students going through final exams coming up, that's always a trying time, so let's be in prayer for them. Lots of traveling going on now, people going to graduations and soon to do their summer vacations and all, so we pray for safety for everyone traveling. I will mention my dad. He's had an eye procedure lately, fighting through some glaucoma, so I'll mention my dad, Bill Ellis. Anything else? Yes, ma'am. Okay, can someone relay that? I didn't hear all of that. Oh, okay. Manny has a hole in her eardrum. Praying for healing. Okay, we'll pray for Maddie's ear. Other concerns? All right, if you would, let's go to the Lord in prayer. So gracious and loving God, we come to you this morning with our praise and our worship, and we raise up our hearts and minds to you. We thank you for hearing all the prayers that have been offered up this morning and raised up to you. And we know that you also hear the ones that we have kept and held in our hearts, Lord. We know you know all about all of that. We ask for your healing for those that need it. We ask for your grace, your presence, your mercy to rest on all of us, Lord. We also thank you for the recent joys and celebrations that many of us have experienced. And it's all due to your love and your generosity, Lord, and we thank you. Please be with all of us today and open our ears, open our hearts this morning so we would hear your word and be transformed into the likeness of your son, Jesus. Help us to be your representatives in the world today and help us to show the love of your son, Jesus, to the people that we meet. Now, God, please bless the reading and hearing of your word. Amen.
Good morning, church. Happy Mother's Day. Wow, that was really bad. Well, thank you, appreciate that. Let's try that again. Happy Mother's Day. All right, I'll work with that one. All right, no problem. Well, it's so good to worship with everyone this morning as we are celebrating Mother's Day today. And we want to also welcome those of us joining us online for our worship this morning. We welcome you to our worship service here at Duluth First. My name is Min Lee. I am one of the staff members here at the church, and I have the honor to have the opportunity to share the word of God with you this morning. And we're continuing in our journey through the letter to the Romans, and we'll be looking at Romans chapter 8, verses 18 through 30 together. So let's go ahead and read our main text for today, starting with verse 18. I believe that the present suffering is nothing compared to the coming glory that is going to be revealed to us. The whole creation waits breathless with anticipation for the revelation of God's sons and daughters. Creation was subjected to frustration, not by its own choice, it was the choice of the one who subjected it, but in the hope that the creation itself will be set free from slavery to decay and brought into the glorious freedom of God's children. We know that the whole creation is groaning together and suffering labor pains up until now. And it's not only the creation, we ourselves who have the Spirit as the first crop of the harvest also groan inside as we wait to be adopted and for our bodies to be set free. We were saved in hope. If we see what we hope for, that isn't hope. Who hopes for what they already see? But if we hope for what we don't see, we wait for it with patience. In the same way, the Spirit comes to help our weakness. We don't know what we should pray, but the Spirit himself pleads our case with unexpressed groans. The one who searches hearts knows how the Spirit thinks, because he pleads for the saints, consistent with God's will. We know that God works all things together for good for the ones who love God, for those who are called according to his purpose. We know this because God knew them in advance, and he decided in advance that they would be conformed to the image of his son. That way his son would be the first of many brothers and sisters. Those who God decided in advance would be conformed to his son, he also called. Those whom he called, he also made righteous. Those whom he made righteous, he also glorified. The word of God for the people of God. Join me in prayer. Gracious and loving God, we thank you so much for our time together as we have come together as your church to worship you and to hear your word. God, we ask that you would soften our hearts this morning, and as your Holy Spirit guides us and leads us, Lord, would you transform our hearts more and more like your Son, Jesus Christ. So, Lord, may we submit this time to you, surrender ourselves to you in this very moment. As you increase, Lord, may we decrease. We thank you, we love you in Christ, and we pray. Amen. I don't know about you guys, but I get super embarrassed when I cry in front of people. Anybody like that here? Like you cry in front of people for some reason and then you're like super embarrassed. Oh, am I the only one? Oh, wow. Oh, okay. Thank you. We have some honest brothers and sisters in this place. All right. So, I get super embarrassed when I cry in front of people. And maybe it's because it leaves me feeling like super vulnerable, right? And nobody wants to feel vulnerable in front of others. Maybe it's that. Or maybe it's because I've seen my ugly cries. You guys know what I'm talking about when I say ugly cries, right? Your face, like, it's like a face you've never seen before in your entire life, right? And to other people, it may look funny, it may look comical, but to you, you're just like, oh man, right? What happened, right? So maybe it's that. Maybe I've seen my face and I'm like, that's not very pleasant to look at, so I'm going to decide that I don't like crying in front of people, right? And I get embarrassed by that. Or maybe it's because I've been told the saying we have in Korea that is taught to children from an early age that men are supposed to cry only 3 times. How many times? 3 times in their lifetime. I know. Wow. 3 times. How is that even possible, right? Let me share with you guys what those 3 times are, right? Or how they list them as. Okay? The first time is when they're born. Makes sense, right? When we're born, we cry, right? That makes sense. Second time is when their parents pass away, right? Which makes sense also. Third time is when they lose their country. Now, that is kind of deeply rooted in the history of the Korean history, but other than that, I don't know where these thoughts or ideas came from and when and how they came about. I have no idea. But the reason why I bring this up is because last Sunday, I had a moment where I choked up, right, and singing a song titled Upon Him. That's a song that we sing here in contemporary worship, especially during communion song. And when we were nearing the end of that song and singing through the chorus together, right, I started to get choked up and I was thinking to myself, uh-oh. Right? I was thinking to myself, uh-oh, because I knew it was going to be one of those ugly cries. And if you were here last Sunday, or if you worshiped with us online, I'm sorry, I apologize for my ugly faces that I made, the ugly cries that I've shown you guys. But I wanted to walk you guys through the song, and I promise there's more to it, to this intro, to this message than just me talking about me crying, okay? There's more to it than that. I wanted to walk you guys through the song and kind of walk you through what took place as we were singing this together as a church, as a body of Christ last Sunday, okay? So the chorus of Upon Him goes like this. Goes, Christ has died, we are forgiven. That's the part when I was like, uh-oh. It's starting, right? And then it goes, in Christ alive, we are the risen, right? And that's when I was like, okay, here it comes, right? Here it comes, this flood of emotions. It's coming. And the next line goes, and he shall come again. And then I lost it. I choked. Tears started falling, right? I made my ugly cry faces. That's when it started to break down. And praise the King, praise the King. That part, I don't even remember singing. Thankfully, we had Caitlin Santos last Sunday with us. I think she sang that part. So Caitlin, thank you so much for singing that part so it's not just like empty or whatnot, right? So as I was thinking through this, right, of course, like after service, I'm talking to my wife while we're eating lunch together. I'm like, honey, I'm so embarrassed, right? I can't believe I cried in front of people, right? And as I was processing this throughout the day, here's the realization I came to. I came to the realization that the Holy Spirit was moving, the Holy Spirit was working and flooding my heart with the message of hope as we were proclaiming that truth together as a family, the hope we have in Christ. Yes, Christ died for us, and we've been forgiven. Yes, Christ is alive, and we are the risen. And yes, we live with the assurance that Jesus shall come again, and we hope and eagerly anticipate the second coming of Jesus and all that is to come. And that hope is what we're going to talk about this morning. Leading up to today's text, Paul explained to the Romans the differences between those who live according to the Spirit and those who live according to the flesh. Then he talks about how the Spirit bears witness with their spirit that we are the children of God. If we are children of God, we are also heirs of God, heirs with Christ, who suffer with him so that we can also be glorified with him. And that's where we pick up in verse 18 today. So let's go ahead and walk through our passage together. Starting with verse 18, it says this. It says, I believe that the present suffering is nothing compared to the coming glory that is going to be revealed to us. Right? When we read this verse, I don't want us to get the impression that Paul is downplaying our sufferings, that Paul is downplaying our struggles in this world. Right? That's not what he's doing. He's not downplaying the experiences of suffering that we experience here on earth, right, in this sin-stricken world. Because Paul, as we know, knew a thing or two about pain and about suffering. Right? But what's important to note here is that Paul is not minimizing the suffering we experience in this world when he says the present suffering is nothing. However, he does make the comparison to let his readers know the glories, okay? The glories that will be revealed to us as God's heirs with Christ will far outweigh the suffering we experience in the present time. Continuing on with verse 19, it says this. It says, the whole creation waits breathless with anticipation for the revelation of God's sons and daughters. Creation was subjected to frustration, not by its own choice, it was the choice of the one who subjected it, but in the hope that the creation itself will be set free from slavery to decay and brought into the glorious freedom of God's children. We know that the whole creation is groaning together and suffering labor pains up until now. And it's not only the creation. We ourselves who have the Spirit as the first crop of the harvest also groan inside as we wait to be adopted and for our bodies to be set free. So here we see that Paul then walks us through this deep longing of all of God's creation for the time when creation will be set free from slavery to decay, and that it's like groaning and suffering labor pains. However, despite its current condition, there is hope that creation will also enter into being set free and participate in the future glory that God's children will enjoy. Moving on to verse 24, says this, says, we were saved in hope. We see that we hope for, we see what we hope for, that is in hope. Who hopes for what they already see? But if we hope for what we don't see, we wait for it with patience. When's the last time that you said to yourself, this to yourself or to someone else, I hope blank, right? And then you can fill in that blank for yourself, right? When was the last time that you walked up to somebody, or maybe it was at a dinner table, or maybe it was you were just hanging out with your friends, or whatever the situation may have been. When was the last time that you've stated or thought to yourself, I hope blank? I hope I do well on this test. Or I hope I get the next promotion and get that big raise. Or I hope the Dodgers will win the World Series this year. Amen. Praying hard for that. I'm sorry, I had to throw that in there. Well, we can pray and be, should we pray and just be done with that? That was a good message, right? Go Dodgers. I'm just kidding. We can all begin to write that I hope statement to fill in that blank with something. But the way we use hope in a lot of ways in our lives is that they're often wishful thinking, right? There's this chance, there are many uncertainties, which means there's no guarantee that those hopes will come to fruition. But the good news for us, brothers and sisters, is that the hope we have and profess, the hope that we have and profess is not just wishful thinking. We hope expectantly and with certainty, and we wait for it with patience But even if we have this hope, right, and even if we try to do our best, it's not always easy trying to be patient, right? Trying to wait. It's not always an easy thing to do. No, maybe waiting at that traffic light and for some reason seems like an eternity when you're running late to a meeting. Ever done that before? Some of us, not many of us. That's good. You guys are very prompt. That's awesome, right? But I've had cases where I was running super late and then it just felt like I was getting caught at every traffic light. And for some reason, the lights would not turn. For some reason, they would just stay red for like eternity, right? I mean, I'm sure most of us, if not all of us, have experienced that before, one way or another. But, or maybe you have some work to do, but either your power is out or your internet is down. Ever experienced that before? And you're just waiting for them to fix it, to get it to working so that you can get back to your work. Or maybe you're like, all right, this must be God's will. I don't have to work for the rest of your day, so I'm going to sign off, right? Or maybe that was your case, but maybe that's one of the experiences you've had in terms of having to wait for something, right? Or maybe you had some health concerns and those results that your doctor is supposed to call you back about cannot come any sooner. Right? Waiting patiently is hard. However, we do so because once again, the hope we have and profess is not just wishful thinking. We hope expectantly and with certainty. Continuing on verse 26, it says this, says, in the same way, the Spirit comes to help our weakness. We don't know what we should pray, but the Spirit himself pleads our case with unexpressed groans. The one who searches hearts knows how the Spirit thinks because he pleads for the saints, consistent with God's will. So here, Paul lets us know that the Holy Spirit comes to help our weakness, right? In particular, our weakness in prayer. There are times we don't know what we need to be praying for. Have you ever been there where you know you need to be praying for something, but you just can't put it to words, right? Our fleshly desires and our short-sightedness often lead us to pray for things that are not in line with God's will. Last time I preached, I shared a bit about my mom, who's a prayer warrior. I mean, she is a woman of prayer, right? And I'm so thankful that I grew up in a household, despite the fact that she used to come into my room at 4:30 in the morning before going to morning prayer, and then holding my hands and then praying over me and then scaring me, like, because I'm like half asleep. It's like, what are you doing here, right? But I'm so thankful for that, right? So this is part two of my mom's prayer journey, okay? So when I think about Paul talking about praying without ceasing in 1 Thessalonians, the first person that comes to my mind is my mom. And a shout out to my mom for Mother's Day. Anyway, I can't exactly remember when this took place, but I clearly remember my mom telling me this, that when she prays for certain things, she'll come to a realization that her prayers are very selfish. And for some of us, that might be kind of like, what does that even mean, right? I mean, isn't praying just in itself a good thing, right, where you're connecting with God? How can your prayers be selfish, right? That may be a question that you have. But my mom, in that conversation, acknowledged that sometimes her prayers are very self-centered, that they're very selfish. And instead of thinking about and praying for her prayers to align, be in line with God's will, that she would pray for her desires to bear fruit. Right, for her desires to come to fruition instead of God's will being done here on earth. But what was amazing to hear also is that my mom shared that the more she prayed about something, if it wasn't in line with God's will, she would start to see a little bit of change in her prayers, the way that she prayed, and that God would transform her prayer so that it would fall in line with God's will, little by more and more, little by little. It wasn't from 0 to 100, but it took some time. It took some work, and it took some work from the Holy Spirit to work in their heart for her prayer to be in line with God's will. But she shared with me that her prayers changed more and more to be in line with God's will. And we can be comforted knowing that the Holy Spirit intercedes on our behalf. That is consistent with God's will. Verse 28 says this. It says, "We know that God works all things together for good for the ones who love God, for those who are called according to his purpose." We know this because God knew them in advance, and he decided in advance, or other translations say predestined, that they would be conformed to the image of his son. That way his son would be the first of many brothers and sisters. Those who God decided in advance would be conformed to his son, he also called. Those whom he called, he also made righteous. Those whom he made righteous, he also glorified. You see, even in our sufferings, God has a way of turning things around and making it good for the believers. Right? It may not necessarily be, quote unquote, good in our eyes. We may not realize it until way later, or we may not even realize it even after a very long time. But we have a promise here that God has a way of turning things around and making it good for the believers. Good in the ways that God sees as good. And it's important to note that when Paul says he, meaning God, decided in advance, or in other translations, he predestined everything, he's not saying that everything, including people's salvation, has already been determined. It is simply working itself out in time. That's not what he's saying here. Instead, it has to do with the foreknowledge of God, that God knows what will happen. And it's to acknowledge the one who responds to God's prevenient grace upon our lives. And the main point that Paul wants to drive home here is that those who are in Christ, God's purpose is for us to be conformed to the image of Christ. For those of us who are Jesus followers, and we have this hope that Paul talks about in his letter to the Romans. Even through sufferings that we may experience in this world, we have this hope in Christ. Then the question that we have to ask ourselves is, what do we do with this hope? Right? What do we do with this hope? As people of hope, and as we eagerly anticipate the future glory that we'll partake in, what are we being called to do here and now? Because we're not meant to let this hope just sit and be, right? That's not what God calls us to do with this hope that we have in Christ. Because and this hope that we have is meant to be woven into the fabric of our lives, in all that we do, in everything that we do, in the way that we talk, in the way that we do things. Whatever aspects of our lives, it's woven into the fabric of our life. So what are we being called to do then? One idea I want to encourage us to reflect upon is being conformed to the image of Christ. That could mean a lot of things for many of us, but what does that look like for you personally? Because for me, it has to do with becoming selfless. Because I don't know about you, but I don't have to work hard at being selfish, do you? Right? I'm pretty good at being selfish. Okay, since it's Mother's Day, honest talk. There have been times when I heard Maddie cry in the middle of the night, and I acted like I was fast asleep. I'll be honest. No judgments thrown here, right? I'll be honest. There have been nights when I'm just like, I hope she gets it. I hope my wife gets it, right? And I'm just laying there, just acting like I'm snoring away. But I'm actually awake. I'm like praying, Maddie, please go to sleep, right? I don't need to work on being selfish. What I do need to work on, and what I need the Holy Spirit to help me with, is to be selfless, which I believe is an image of Christ that we all bear as Christ followers. You know, a few months ago, I was running some errands on a Sunday afternoon, getting ready for youth group. And that evening, I needed to get some coffee because I was like super tired, right? So I was like, oh, I need some caffeine. So I went to Starbucks, right? And after I got my drink and I was coming out and trying to get in my car, I saw this couple, right? Their car wasn't starting, right? And then we all know what that sounds like when the car doesn't start, right? You get that little engine ticking sound, right? And then they're like struggling, they're trying to figure it out. And eventually this guy, he was pushing his car back so that it wouldn't get in the way of other people in the parking lot, right? So I saw that and I thought to myself, maybe I should help, right? But then the next thing I knew, what I was doing was I was in my car, right? I don't know what happened. I just kind of like, I saw the need and thought to myself, I should help them. And the next thing I know I'm doing is I'm in my car ready to start the car, right? So I started the car. I'm about to pull out, and then I feel this overwhelming conviction in my heart, right? And I'm like, oh gosh, right? Oh gosh, right? And I felt this conviction to go and help these people, right? To jumpstart the car. And you know how long it took me? They actually had the jumper cable and everything. All they needed was a car to help the car get jump started. Do you guys know how long it took me for me to be able to do that? Just 5 minutes. 5 minutes out of my so-called such a busy and stressful and chaotic life, all it took was 5 minutes of my life for me to be able to be able to serve these people, to love on these people, to be selfless instead of being selfish. And yet, even that was a battle in itself. So when I think of conforming into the image of Christ, I need to depend on the Holy Spirit to convict me and become aware of my selfishness and help me to be more like Christ in giving myself to serve others. And we can be an extension of hope to others when we make ourselves available to serve and give ourselves to others. We can be an extension of hope to others when we meet people in their struggles. I'll close with this. A couple weeks ago, our youth group and some of our adult volunteers and parents and David Burch and Ken Woolley, we went to a nonprofit organization called Satisfeed to serve the community. And it was really an awesome experience that we got to do that. We got to serve so many families who are in need of food, right? And what Satisfeed does as an organization, it's an organization that provides hunger relief for Gwinnett's families in need, right? They provide food co-op and support, and weekend support programs to fight food insecurity and reduce food waste. And as I was kind of browsing through their website, this really broke my heart. It says, according to their website, it says 13% of people in North Georgia turn to food pantries and meal service programs. 14% of Gwinnett's population live below the poverty line, and 20% of children in Gwinnett County are food insecure. Now that I'm a parent, that hits me in a different way, right? And that might hit in a different way for you, whether it's your children or for whoever in your life, that might hit you in a different way. But especially now that I'm a parent, I can't imagine what it would feel like not being able to put food on the table or having to choose from paying different bills or to go to the grocery store to buy more food for the family, right? I can't imagine being in that sort of a situation, in that sort of a hardship or suffering that they had to endure time and time again, week in and week out. There are so many people, though, at Satisfeed who came out to serve, who made themselves available and gave themselves to offer hope to others. There were so many families we were able to help by distributing food and to meet these families in their struggles. It was an opportunity for us to let these families know that they're not alone. And isn't that one of the most difficult things when we're struggling, when we're suffering, that we feel like we're all alone in it, that there's nobody else that understands it, there's nobody else that can help us, right? We feel all alone, and that's got to be one of the most difficult things that we experience as a human being, that we are alone in our struggles. But I was so thankful for the opportunity, and I was so thankful and so proud of our group that we got to go and to serve and to love as Christ calls us to. to meet these families in their struggles. Because each and every one of those families matter to Jesus, which means they should also matter to us. I have no doubt that the smiles we saw on their faces of these people were not only thankfulness for the food that they were receiving, that they were given, but a response to the hope that was being shared in that very moment. And perhaps even letting some of these families know that there is hope when hopelessness tries to overshadow them. So brothers and sisters, whether it's as an individual in our day-to-day lives, or whether it's as a community, as a body of Christ, as people of hope, we're being called to be distributors of hope. So then may we respond faithfully here and now as we eagerly anticipate the future glory that is going to be revealed to us. Let's pray together. Gracious and loving God, we thank you once again for your word. And we thank you that we are people of hope. No matter what the world may try to tell us, no matter what circumstances may try to tell us, Lord, we have this solid foundation of the hope that we have in you, in your Son, for what he has done for us on that cross. And Lord, we also have that hope of your coming, your second coming, Lord, where the fullness of your kingdom will be realized here on earth, and that we'll be able to partake in that future glory as co-heirs with Christ. God, we thank you for that hope. And we ask that you would help us to share that hope with those around us as your Spirit leads, as your Spirit guides. We thank you, Lord. In Christ, let me pray. Amen.
I want to invite Caitlin Santos up. If you're not familiar with Caitlin, she helps lead up here now that she's home for a little bit, and she came through our youth group and was an integral part of our youth group and a leader for I don't know how many years before I ever got here. And she had led worship, and then she was gone for a while. Now she's back. We wanted to invite Caitlin to come and share with us why she was gone for a while. She went to El Salvador to do some ministry with her grandmother, and her mother went down for a week to serve down there also. So we asked Caitlin to come and share her experiences in El Salvador with that on that mission trip and doing it, serving in ministry for that couple months you were down there. And let y'all know, with your faithful giving and generosity, trips like this we can make possible. We can offer these and make them happen with your generosity and your faithfulness. So if you would like to see more trips like this, let us know and continue in your giving, and we will make these happen. So I'm going to turn it over to Caitlin for a couple of minutes. If you'd give her your what is this? Give her your attention.
It's because I'm excited. Hello, buenos dias. Good. I'm so glad you guys responded. The 8:30 service, they were like, what do we do? I'm like, it's okay to say buenos dias. It's fine. So thank you, David, for the introduction. I'm so excited because this service actually gets pictures. The last service couldn't get pictures. Man, you guys get like the whole thing. So this is awesome. It's also awesome because it's Mother's Day, so Feliz Día de las Madres to all the mothers. As David said, this was definitely a generational project. I mean, I had my abuelita, I had my mom. I mean, me, it was like, man, like powerful women working in ministry. It was really awesome, and a lot of cool things happened. And so I'm going to share about some of those things. If you want to go to the next slide. Yeah, so they see this is my my abuelita, that's us. She is a very inspirational woman. She's actually the reverend of two congregations in El Salvador. She's also a U.S. immigration attorney, a teacher, a counselor. She's a whole thing and a big inspiration to me. We can go to the next one. So there are two churches that I worked in. The first one is La Concordia. La Concordia is a church based in the city, San Salvador. The majority of this church is actually made up of special needs individuals, and the ages range from 5 all the way to 60. And so on top of that, they have, why this was started, this ministry was started, is because my abuelita herself, she has a son with special needs. This is my mother's brother, Tio Richard, and there will be a picture soon, but she started this ministry to give special needs kids a place to call home, where they could feel accepted, they could feel loved, and where the parents could feel comfortable to worship, and she provides support groups and all sorts of events for these kids, which is really special that I could work in special needs ministry. The next church that I worked in, and this is the next slide, was in Guaymango. Guaymango is actually a city. I wouldn't call it a city. It's more like farmlands out in the middle of nowhere, practically. I'd say about 98% of the people who are living in this city are in severe poverty. But it is a growing and thriving church, about 100 to 150 every Sunday, Thursday. And there are lots of babies and lots of kids and young adults, which is a thriving church. I had the pleasure to work with the youth specifically. We played all sorts of games. I took a lot of the things that I learned here in youth group and brought it there, which is really cool. And I even taught them how to grill, which is a funny story. So if you want to hear it, you can ask me after. But these are a lot of the kids and the youth that I worked with here. And in the next slide, I want to talk about a particular event, and this was our biggest event, and a lot of my funding went into this spectacular thing. It's the coolest thing I've ever gotten to do. We created a party, a fiesta, for the kids in Concordia, who are special needs. As I said, a lot of these kids with special needs, they don't have special education, they don't get hardly anything. They don't get recognition. It's very much not like how it is here, where they get a lot of this specialized attention. And so we hosted a huge party for them where each of them got a crown, they had a coordination, they felt like the most special people alive, as they should. It was the best night of their lives, full of dancing, food, and all sorts of things. And that's my uncle up there. I'm dancing with him. I have the white dress, and he just had a blast. He is not a party person, but that night he was like, got dressed up, he was ready to go, and that was an incredible blessing. With that, I do want to say a special thank you to all of you, especially here in the contemporary service. You guys have kind of seen me in this preparation and have helped me in this preparation as I've been coming here. I could not have done it without several of you at all, if you, for your prayers and whatever you gave monetary, even if it was medicines, Kay sent me with allergy medicine, and boy, I had to use it when I went down there. And, you know, so all these things were a huge help. I also, I love this picture. This is their smiles. I also want to encourage you all that, we're all called to be missionaries. Now, for some of you, that doesn't necessarily mean you have to go across the world. For some of you, that means that you can go to your neighbor. You can go to your friends who are in need. Those of us who went to Buffalo, that was so cool. Mission work looks like very different things for many of us. And it even includes funding missionaries who are out on the field and who are doing things. And so I want to encourage you this morning, and if you have any sort of doubt in your mind about, well, I don't know if I can do this, trust that God will provide everything that you need to get the job done. And so thank you guys for all your support, And if you want more pictures or if you want to learn more, please come ask me because I could talk about it for hours. But with what little time I have, thank you.
Thank you, Caitlin. You're awesome. If you will, rise and let us sing our last worship song. Are not a member of this church and been visiting with us, and how about men this morning? Wasn't that a great message that he brought us? Thank you, men. You're awesome. So we would love for you to join us and be a part of our family. So please come up during this time, and you can also have more information online. Men's trying to tell me what to say, and I'm not listening to him. So, so we'd love for you to be a part of us. So let us sing worship. Cornerstone, he is our cornerstone.
Cornerstone, weak made strong.
with trumpet sound. On may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness.
Please be seated. Let me go ahead and run through some announcements for us. Please make sure to get your Sunday supplement newsletter if you haven't done so already. All the information that I'm about to share are included here. First, we have our Sunday Fun Day that's coming up next Sunday. And it's going to be a great event for all ages, so I want to encourage everybody to invite your family members, your friends, and your neighbors, whoever you can invite. We want to encourage everybody to do that. And secondly, we have, I lost my sheet. I am so sorry. the next announcement, and I will see what Ken puts up in the back. Thank you, Ken. VBS, Vacation Bible School. It's from June 12th through June 16th, and it is free for all participants. And we are still looking for more volunteers, and there is a wish list. And the links are in, not only included in the Sunday supplement, but you can find all this information on our website, duluthumc.org. So please sign up to volunteer, or please help us to be able to put together this Vacation Bible School that will bring about so much hope for our community, not just our church members and our children from our church, but from children from just our local community as well. So please check that out as well. And last but not least, Ken Woolley has put together this great information card. It's an online giving card, and it has all the information on how you can give online. And there's a QR code that you can scan with your phone for it to take you directly to our website. So if you haven't gotten one of these, please take a look at it. And once again, we thank you guys so much for your faithfulness and for your generosity in allowing everything that we do together as a church possible here at Duluth First United Methodist Church. I think that's everything. So let's... Who's hungry? Let's all go over to the Rainy Fellowship, Dorothy Fellowship Hall, and then let's get some goods for our stomach and continue in our fellowship. But with that being said, let's all rise together to our feet as able, and would you receive this benediction? As we go forth from this place, we ask that you will continue to fill our hearts with the hope, with the gift of hope that you place in our hearts, God. And as we go forth from this place, Lord, may we continue to be an extension and distributors of your hope to those around us. As we continue to shine your light brightly in the places that you send us, wherever that may be. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. All right, have a great week, everybody.